Beginning with this version of PI right here, we started supporting Windows Integrated Security. And in this video, what we're going to look at is how to configure what's known as an identity that makes use of Active Directory users or groups to allow somebody to connect to the PI server. Now, we're not in this video going to be talking about setting up security for tag configuration for editing tags. We actually do that in a separate video called PI Tag Security Configuration. That's coming up next. For right now, we'll get to the point where you can create a user, a Windows user, create what's called a PI identity, and then by making use of that identity, we'll go ahead and grant that user access to the PI server. So the key here to granting access using Windows Integrated Security is this concept here called a PI identity. A PI identity is a construct we've created that allows you to basically to associate certain privileges with that identity, and the most basic privilege being just world access, meaning the ability to even connect to the PI server. And we map those identities to these Windows users. So users come in really two flavors. First you have the individual users, then you have individual groups of users, Windows Active Directory groups. Either of those can be mapped over here to this what's known as a PI identity. So that PI identity gets mapped to a Windows user, and that's how we accomplish it. So let me show you what it looks like in action here. I'll demonstrate a user who has privileges to connect. What we're looking at is a PI server, and I'll go into this right here. This is under PI system, the PI system management tools. And I'm going to go into the security section. Actually, mine's already open here. And if we take a look at this construct, this identity here called PI soup is an identity that I've created specifically to allow users, certain Windows users, to connect to the PI system. If we look at our mappings, we can see we've mapped this to this is actually a group, an Active Directory group in a domain called Virtual Labs, and the name of the group is called Solution Soup. But I could add other Windows users to this particular identity here, or this mapping, I should say. I can map other users to this identity. In this case, I've just mapped the one group of users. Now, that's going to help anybody who's in that group. And if we take a look at our Active Directory users here, we'll look at this group called solution_sup. It's an Active Directory group. And in this case, we have we actually have two users, one called Solution Sam Jones, Solution Sid Smith. Now, these are domain users. So if anybody logs on as a domain user, that domain user, through this mechanism that we call the mapping here, that domain user gets mapped to PI supervisors, or this PI soup identity. What privileges does PI soup have? Actually, PI soup has no privileges, but it is a named user. It is an identified identity. So it does have one privilege, and that is it has the privilege of world, basically being or meaning that it is a valid user. So at the least, it's going to be able to connect to the PI server. Let me go ahead and demonstrate. I'm going to go ahead and close out this virtual machine. That's my virtual server. I'm going to open up my virtual interface node. This is a separate computer that we've been using for interface testing. It's a separate virtual machine, and it's connected to the PI server. Now, this particular user that I'm logged in as right now, the user I'm logged in as right now on this machine is the administrator. And the administrator is, well, he's not that user that I had identified just a second ago. He's the administrator. So if I attempt to connect to this PI server using this connection dialog here, you're going to notice it's going to fail. It's going to fail because administrator, though he may be a big deal over here on this computer, he really doesn't have any privileges over on the PI server. So who does have privileges on the PI server? Well, if you recall, it was that user called, I think we called him solution_Sid and Sam. So what I'm going to do is go ahead and log off and log back in as a new user. Okay, now here's where I would go to go ahead and log in as that user, solution_Sam. And what you'll notice is, unlike the administrator, when I log on as solution_sam, when I attempt to connect, because there is an identity that maps that Windows user to, or I should say, because there's a mapping. Now what you'll notice is, when I attempt to connect to the PI server this time, because there's a mapping that maps that Windows user, solution_sam, to an identity that exists as a legitimate, you know, PI user or PI identity, then that's going to allow me to connect. Just the fact that it exists, even if I don't have any privileges, it's still going to allow me to connect. So I'll go ahead and choose connections. And I'll go ahead and choose, you'll look right down here. What you'll see is how I'm going to be connecting. So I click on there, and it should tell me how I connected. And yes, it says I connected as solution_sam. And even though this is the default is PI demo here, this is actually a connection mechanism that will kick in only if some of these other, the Windows integrated security fails. So in this case, we don't attempt that. We just go ahead and connect as that user. So that's quite a bit different than if I had logged in as administrator and tried it. As you saw when I did that, it just didn't allow me the connection. So to demonstrate, let me do it from scratch. I'll just go ahead and create a brand new user, as many of you might have to do. This user, we want them to be able to connect to PI. And that's all we're going to do right now. Just give them access to connect to PI. We're not going to set up any point-by-point security at this point. So my PI server also happens to be the server that's running Active Directory. So I'll configure a new Active Directory user. And we've got a SID and a SAM. Let me create a new one. We'll call this guy Sal. And we'll go ahead and set him up thus. So there's Sal. If I wanted to, what I could do is I could create a new Active Directory group and then put Sal in that group. I want to keep it simple this time, though, because when you create an identity, you can associate or map that identity to either a group or a user. In this case, just to demonstrate, I'll map it to a user, this Sal test. Okay. Now you will notice that in the previous example, we actually had mapped this, what is his name, Solution Sam. Yeah, he was actually mapped to a group. When we look at his properties, you can see he was a member of something called solution_soup, and that's what I had used to map that solution_soup Active Directory group to my identity. So it was because of his membership in there that he was granted the privileges of that identity that I created. But in this case, we're going to keep it a little bit simpler. We'll just simply map him using this Sal test. So I've done just about everything I need to do over here. Let me go ahead and go into the PI system under the, this is PI SMT, and I'll create a new identity that will grant him permission. So let's choose new identity. For this, I'll just call this Sal's identity. And that doesn't really accomplish much until I map that identity to something. I need to map this through this mappings and trusts. You can also map it over here. I can go ahead and create a new mapping, and then at this point I can go ahead and specify the identity. So either way, you know, here's the identity I just created, Sal's identity. Either way, probably the easier way is just go back into that identity and let's map this identity I created to that Sal as the user, the Active Directory user. I'll go ahead and choose add. I need to go out and find Sal. I'll go ahead and check the names. And there we go, Sal test. That's the user. And he's mapped, as you can see, to this identity called Sal's identity. There we go. So the big finish, even though we really haven't given him any privileges now, there we go. Now, the grand finale to this is that he should be able to connect using that user, the Windows user called SalTest, because he does have he is mapped to a valid identity. He doesn't have any privileges as that identity, but he is mapped to a valid identity. So to properly test this, let me go ahead and launch that remote session where I'm going to log in as Sal. He was this domain user. And let me type in his password. And as soon as this launches, we should be able to test to see if Sal can connect, and how he connects will be important. We'll keep an eye on the bottom right-hand side of our screen when we do that connect. So under PI System, we're going to go into PI System Management Tools. We'll run that same connection dialog we saw before a couple of times, in which, remember, the administrator failed to connect. So if we go into File Connections, now, having logged in as Sal, my brand new user, should be able to connect. And there we go. Here's our big finish. Virtual Labs slash Sal is the user we're currently connecting with. It's his credentials that are being passed on to the PI server, and it's through that mapping that we map that Windows user Sal to that identity called Sal's identity. And that's what, because he is a legitimate user, that's what gets grants him access. Now, there's a few things I haven't mentioned yet about identities. First of all, there are four default identities that you will find in the PI server when we first install it. It's these four right here: engineers, operators, supervisors, and PI world. And you know what? The first three here, you can pretty much forget about them and ignore them if you want to, because we just put them there as a kind of a courtesy, or just a kind of a, you know, here's something to get you started. But they really don't have any specific privileges or any restrictions. And in fact, you can, if you want to, you can just go ahead and delete these if you want. They don't really do any, you know, do anything that's specific or useful in the system, other than give you a mechanism for starting to divide up how your Windows users or Windows groups are going to be organized. In that case, we just had an identity called PI Engineers, and presumably that's where you would map all of your Windows users who are engineers. Since I deleted it, I can just as soon put it back or create a new identity for my engineers that's called something else. Doesn't really matter. Now, this fourth identity is called PI World. Now, that's one that actually you cannot delete. The PI World identity is basically the identity that any validated PI user is mapped to. So if we have a user who's validated either through a trust or through a login, he's going to be mapped to PI World. As you can see, it's described as this built-in identity, and it's something that, although you can rename it if you want, for whatever reason, you can't really delete it. Now, another thing about identities is a mapping of a Windows user can only occur with one identity. So in this case, Sal cannot be mapped to another identity. Now, if you want Sal to have the benefit of being associated with more than one identity, you can create multiple Active Directory groups, make Sal a member of each of them, and then an identity can be mapped to more than one group. That's not a problem. Now, lastly, if you create mappings, you have the option when you create that mapping to associate that Windows account, as we saw, with a PI identity. But in addition to associating with a PI identity, you can actually associate it with a PI group or a PI user. Now, both of them are less desirable. Groups and users are still supported because that's originally the only mechanism we had for security in PI. You could have groups of what we call PI users or individual PI users. We don't suggest you create mappings to those groups and users. We suggest you go ahead and make use of this new identity concept. That's where all of our strongest security is associated now, and where all of our development in the future will be. So although you can map to individual PI users and PI groups, we suggest you instead map to identities and then use those identities when it comes to setting up specific privileges for certain protected objects or secure objects. And we'll talk more about those secure objects, you know, those points, etc., that can be edited only by certain people in our next video.